Hey guys, this is Frankie Edgar, and you're listening to Submission Radio.
Hey, this is Rich Franklin.
What's up, everybody? This is Chris Weidman.
This is Diego Sanchez.
Randy Couture.
Alistair Overeem.
Hi, this is Stephen Bonner.
This is Don Fry.
Hey, I'm Phil, Mr. Wonderful Davis.
TJ Dillashaw.
And you're listening to Submission Radio.
Submission Radio.
Submission Radio.
Submission Radio.
You're listening to Submission Radio.
Welcome to Submission Radio on the 14th of December, the UFC 194 special. Dennis Grouter here with Kacper Ozalowski. Kas, a different type of episode of Submission Radio from the usual episode the fans are used to.
It's different, but it's something that we really love doing. We haven't done one of these since the landmark event of UFC 189, where we got a whole bunch of journalists and fun MMA personalities to help break down the show. Last time it was Tommy Toehold and Dave Meltzer. This time we figured, you know what, we'll get some other names to help break down the madness of not only UFC 194, but just some of the previous events of this massive fight week that has just finished. A big breath of fresh air. We've got, who have we got? We've got Kirik Jenness from the Underground, legendary pioneer in MMA, and obviously we've got Duane Finley, who writes amazing pieces on fighters and their stories. He works on UFC.com and Bleacher Report and other places like that. They are going to be helping us break down these massive amounts of fights. I believe we're going to be touching on the main events of the Tough Finale and obviously the Paige VanZant, Rose Namajunas card, and then it's going to be all full steam ahead on everything UFC 194. Also, got another sexy special guest. Dennis, who else do we have on the episode?
Well, that's right. It's all about perspectives here on Submission Radio, so we got a whole bunch of them. Paul Dollery from The 42 will join us. He's one of the top MMA journalists in Ireland. He's going to be talking about Conor McGregor from an Irish perspective. How big is he really in Ireland? What does this win mean? His thoughts. He was there all throughout fight week. He'll give us the lowdown. I can't wait to speak to him. And also, someone that we enjoy having in our breakdowns, a character in MMA, Tommy Toehold, will be on Submission Radio, and he will give us his top five moments from the weekend. I can't wait to hear what he says, Cass.
But this is going to be different, because normally when we have Tommy Toehold on, we have the real person. We have him out of character. This time, it's going to be Tommy Toehold in character giving us these top five moments. So something a bit of fun, almost like the Super Bowl when you get those sexy commercials and everybody looks forward to. That'll be around the middle of the episode. I believe Paul Dollery is first, Tommy Toehold somewhere in the middle, and then we got our big juicy breakdown with Kirik and Duane Finley. As always, you can follow us on Twitter at SubmissionAUS. We love interacting with you guys on Facebook, facebook.com/SubmissionRadioAU. Don't forget, drop some comments in the comment section below if you're watching this on YouTube. Let us know what you thought of UFC 194. Don't forget to hit that like button. And we can always be found on all podcast platforms such as iTunes, Stitcher, TuneIn Radio, SoundCloud, iTunes, everything, every podcast platform there is. It's going to be a pretty big show, isn't it, Dennis?
Yeah, I can't wait to get into a cast. And also, guys, if you haven't had a chance, jump on the YouTube channel, youtube.com/submissionradioAU. A bunch of UFC 194 content. We'll get more into what kind of content we have at the end of the show, but there are a bunch of scrum interviews with the biggest names in MMA, in the UFC, and also all the post-fight stuff, the Conor McGregor post-fight press conference, and little clips detailing the highlights of that post-fight press conference, and now live on the channel, so make sure you check them out.
Yeah, it's absolutely stacked. And just obviously to mention, if you are listening to Submission Radio for the first time, this is not normally how a show goes. We do have breakdowns, but generally speaking, it's three guests. Just to sort of recap, last week we had Michael Bisping, Chael Sonnen, and Lance Palmer. The week before that, we had Ricardo Lamas, Urijah Faber, Mike Dolce. Week before that, we had Ken Shamrock, Mark Hunt, The Voice. Always a ton of guests on Submission Radio, but this is a special, it's a breakdown special for UFC 194. When you have such a massive week and such a monumental happenings in MMA, you have to take some time to not necessarily interview people, just break things down. And I believe one of the people that will help us break it down is on the line right now, isn't it, Dennis?
Our next guest is one of the top MMA journalists in Ireland working for the 42. He was on hand for Conor McGregor's massive win yesterday, coming straight out of Vegas. Paul Dollery, welcome to Submission Radio. It's a pleasure to have you.
Yeah, great to be on the show, guys. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, no, it's fantastic to have you on the show. And we thought, you know, who better as far as insight goes. Before we get into UFC 194, let's get something straight. We see it on TV, the UFC's promos, but how big is Conor McGregor? How big is he actually in Ireland?
Yeah, it's a good question, because in Ireland, we kind of have these three main sports. We have soccer, rugby, and our own national sports, Gaelic Games. And, you know, they are without a shadow of a doubt the three biggest sports, and they always will be, and that's never going to change. But it's kind of interchangeable what comes in fourth and fifth place then. I mean, for the last few years, you've had things like golf and maybe, you know, basketball and stuff like that. There's been a mix of different sports kind of challenging for those next few places in line. But in the last couple of years, obviously, MMA has come out of nowhere in Ireland, and it kind of seems to be occupying that spot at the moment. And it's all because of Conor, let's be honest. You know, he's the one kind of carrying the flag for that. And just judging by, you know, just the traffic from our own website, certainly there is no other individual sports star in Ireland that garners the kind of interest that Conor does at the moment. As I mentioned, the big names in Irish sport come from those three big sports like rugby, soccer and Gaelic games. We have guys like Jonathan Sexton, who's the out half for the Ireland rugby team, Paul O'Connell, who's the captain, who's just retired. And of course, our soccer team, they're doing pretty well at the moment. They've gotten to the European Championships, which is kind of a punching above our weight kind of thing. We're not very good, but you know, we work hard, and the team has a lot of heart, and they, you know, they punch above their weight and they do quite well. So but we don't really have any big names on the football team at the moment. We had Roy Keane for years, who's obviously now retired for quite a while. So yeah, there is kind of a vacancy for a big superstar, I guess, and Conor is certainly occupying that at the moment. There is just an absolute fascination with the guy, and I think it stems from the fact that Ireland, as a small country, there are very few sports that we're actually the best in the world at. So when somebody like Conor comes along and has the potential to genuinely be one of the best in the world, everybody gets behind. And we've seen it in other kind of sports previously. You know, if an Irish athlete happens to win an Olympic medal unexpectedly, that sport then all of a sudden becomes the in thing. And that's kind of what's happened with MMA in the last couple of years. And the fascination with Conor as well is that, you know, because we are a small country, we're always the underdog. We're never the cocky, arrogant favourite. And because of that, with the way Conor is, people are just absolutely fascinated by him. And that's kind of the origin for the interest in him, I guess.
It's interesting because there's so many parallels between Ireland and Australia. We've got the same thing happening with sports down here. It's one time the Socceroos, which was our soccer team, did all right, and now soccer sort of exploded a little bit here across Australia. But let me ask you, Paul, with Conor's popularity, can you pinpoint when he really hit that niche and became popular? Was it after he beat Chad Mendes and became the interim champion, or was it well before that he became a huge star over there?
Yeah, I think it was pretty much from the UFC debut against Marcus Brimage, because Ireland had never been represented in the UFC up until that point. We had Tom Egan, who fought at UFC 93 in 2009. But, you know, with all due respect to Tom, he was the token Irish guy brought in because the UFC were coming to Dublin, and it was much too early for him to be on that level of a stage. So Conor was really the first one. And you know, as I said, when people saw this guy coming out of nowhere, and you know, he was cocky in his predictions and he was entertaining and stuff like that, that was when he was a household name really from that UFC debut. And just since then, it's just kind of multiplied with each fight. But the Mendes fight, as you mentioned, was actually a big turning point, because the attitude to Conor in Ireland is actually pretty much reflective of what it's like elsewhere in the world. It's, you know, a lot of people really support him, and you know, they don't take his antics too seriously, and they're really entertained by him. But a lot of people, you know, they're not his biggest fans, and they get kind of upset by the way he carries himself. And you know, they up until the Mendes fight, they kind of read into the propaganda of people saying that Conor were, you know, he was being protected from certain styles of opponent. But when they saw him beating Chad Mendes, even his kind of begrudgers thought, okay, well, you know, He might be kind of irritating every once in a while, but obviously he is one of the best in the business. So that that Mendes fight was a bit of a sea change in opinion in Ireland in terms of his detractors. But what happened obviously last night with Jose Aldo, it has just brought that onto another level again.
Well, it's amazing that people found him like that in Ireland as well, because in the common notion for everyone who was in Ireland was that, you know, in Ireland he can do no wrong. So it's interesting to hear you say that. Now, you're obviously based out of Ireland, Paul, but you were in Vegas to cover UFC 194. You watched Conor do his usual rounds of media obligations during this past fight week. Did anything stand out to you about the way he carried himself, or, you know, just what he looked like that maybe differed from how he usually conducts himself during fight week?
Yeah, so I got in here on Tuesday evening. So my first encounter with Conor was the press conference on Wednesday. And I think everybody saw that he was just a lot calmer than he normally is. And you started to wonder if that was a kind of a gesture to Aldo, if he was trying to throw Jose Aldo off a little bit, because up until that point, every press obligation that they'd been through together, you know, Conor was snarling at him and he was getting in his face and stuff like that. It was just a complete change. And then on Thursday at the workouts, it was pretty much similar. You know, there was no trash talk. he was as confident as he's ever been. You know, the language was the same. You know, he was saying he was going to finish Aldo in the first round and that it was going to be an easy win for him. But it was just the way he delivered it was a lot different. And yeah, he just seemed, it wasn't even confidence. It was just certainty that even though this is my toughest fight yet, it's going to be a victory without a shadow of a doubt. It was fascinating to see how confident he was of beating this guy who hadn't been beaten for 10 years. And, you know, I think a lot of people believed he could do it. I believed he could do it. I tipped him to win maybe in the third or fourth round. But nobody could predict the way he finished the fight in that manner, you know?
Mm. But when Jose Aldo was walking out to the octagon for the fight, a lot of people are trying to interpret what was going on. He had his head down for a lot of it, seemed a bit nervous and obviously a little bit emotional. What did you notice about Aldo in the fight week as well? Was there anything that showed hints of McGregor's trash talk or the pressure of the huge fight week getting to him that you saw?
Yeah, I actually found it to be the opposite. He seemed really relaxed as well himself on Wednesday at the press conference. On Thursday at the workouts, he looked to be in good spirits. And of course, at the weigh-ins, then on Friday, he actually seemed to kind of strike a psychological blow to McGregor when he kind of mimicked his stance. So everything was pointing in the right direction for Aldo. He didn't seem like he was carrying any of the animosity from the year-long build-up on his shoulders. And yeah, I suppose it's easy to kind of look at his demeanor now during the fight and kind of walking out and stuff and look for little telltale signs. There's actually, there was some footage online earlier on of Joe Rogan. You can actually hear his conversation with the UFC's production team, which obviously didn't go out on the broadcast. And Rogan was pointing out how he said Aldo looked soft, and Rogan had actually changed his prediction for the fight based on those few seconds beforehand. He said Aldo doesn't look himself. I gotta be honest, I didn't see that myself. You know, you're trying to look for these telltale signs and look for little things and read between the lines. And I didn't see anything from Aldo that made me think any different to what I did originally. You know, he's always kind of been renowned for keeping his head down when he's standing in his corner. When they come in for the, you know, when the referee brings them together beforehand. So, yeah, I guess it's easy to say now that maybe things weren't right, but I certainly couldn't have picked up on any indication beforehand.
Well, let me ask you, Paul, what were some of the highlights from the Irish fans in Vegas? Because obviously you were there, you know, was there a massive party feel after McGregor won in town? Did you see anything crazy?
Yeah, there was plenty of crazy things going on. It was different actually to 189 back in July, because it was in the summer as well. A lot of the Irish fans came out a little bit earlier and made a kind of a summer holiday out of it, and a lot of young Irish people spent a lot of time in the US during the summer anyway, so it was probably a slightly larger presence, and they were around for a bit longer in the week, so you got to see a little bit more. And I think this time, because it's so close to Christmas and a lot of the fans would have spent their money back in July as well, they kind of came out later. I spoke to a lot of fans who had actually picked up cheap flights in the last couple of weeks and just made a kind of a last minute decision to come out. And a couple of people were saying, you know, we're only here for 2 days, so we're not going to go to bed. We're going to, you know, make the most of the celebrations and the Vegas lifestyle and whatever. But yeah, for the most part, it was good fun. You know, they had a few drinks and they were dancing around the lobby in the MGM Grand, and they weren't really getting into trouble. One or two guys obviously took it a little bit too far, but that's bound to happen when you've got such a large group of people in a place like Vegas. I don't know if you guys picked up on the story as well, but there was actually an incident on a flight that I had over from New York that had to turn around, which is not great. You know, you don't want to really be hearing stories like that. But when you consider the number of people who came over, there was possibly 10,000 Irish people in Vegas for the fight, and you're always going to get a couple of bad eggs who are going to ruin it for everybody. But yeah, they made the most of the celebrations last night. I don't really think anybody got any sleep.
Let's talk about John Kavanagh, a guy that obviously you know quite well because you work with him for the 42. He made some comments about McGregor not going down to 145 anymore. What do you know about how all of this started and what's really behind it, Paul?
I think, you know, everybody knows that McGregor is really big for 145. He's a huge featherweight, and that's a massive advantage for him. I spoke to John about the whole weight cutting thing last week because of the fact that this was the first event that Conor was going to be cutting down to 145 without the benefit of an IV to rehydrate. And, you know, John, it wasn't a massive concern for him. He wasn't worried about the impact of it, but he was making the point himself that, you know, when he first got into MMA, he didn't get into it, you know, to see who could be the bigger guy or to see who could cut most weight. He got into it to see who was the better martial artist. And I think in MMA, we've probably become obsessed with weight cutting, and it's almost a challenge in itself to see how low you can get. But yeah, there is definitely a kind of an opinion from their point of view that they want to try and kind of maybe, you know, tick the box of the featherweight division as quickly as they possibly can and move up. But Conor then as well, of course, you know, the way he is, he just wants to do things differently to any way they've been done before. And he wants to hold two belts simultaneously, which probably differs slightly, I'd imagine, from what John's outlook is. You know, I think he wants to, as I said, just, you know, cross this featherweight division off, tick that box, you know, dominate, and then move up to 155 and try and do the same there. But looking at Conor, I mean, I actually spoke to Donald Cerrone on Saturday afternoon. He was here as one of the guest fighters for media. He made a really good point. You know, McGregor, while he is a big featherweight, he wouldn't be a massive lightweight. And just kind of standing next to Cerrone and having been standing next to McGregor during the week, you know, Cerrone and some of those guys in the lightweight division, and even Sage Northcutt, that guy is absolutely massive. You know, they're really big men for 155, and if McGregor makes the move up, he'll automatically lose that size advantage, which has been such a massive thing for him at 145. So it's going to be interesting to see how they handle that. Are they going to try and juggle the two for a while and see how that goes? And are the UFC going to allow them to do that? Because, you know, it's something they haven't really done in the past traditionally, is, you know, allow guys to compete in both divisions, and certainly allow guys to compete at the top. You know, McGregor is adamant that he wants to hold two belts simultaneously. But yeah, it's going to be really interesting to see how that plays out from both sides.
It could be something that works very well, or just unravels itself and really affects his career. Another issue, well, not really an issue, but something that McGregor is going through right now is contract negotiations with the UFC to figure out what his contract will be like in the future. A few people wondering if this will take some time, if the UFC will give him the deal that he's looking for. Not really much out on this, but what do you know about these contract negotiations? And from what you feel, do you think this will be nice and smooth and get done pretty quickly?
Yeah, there was some talk around with some of the other journalists during the week that there was maybe a little bit of friction with McGregor and the UFC over the past couple of weeks, because he's been mentioning this unprecedented $100 million contract a lot in interviews over the last while. And I presume it's a ploy to put a little bit of pressure on the UFC. But yeah, he mentioned, I think, in an interview with Ariel Helwani last night that a contract had possibly been agreed and that he was satisfied with it. So it looks like maybe they have come to some sort of an agreement on that front. But just looking at the aftermath of such an emphatic win over Jose Aldo, it really has put the ball in Conor McGregor's court. And I think he's also helped by Ronda Rousey's defeat a few weeks ago, you know, because the UFC certainly didn't want to be in a position going into Christmas where all of a sudden they're starting 2016 with both Conor McGregor and Ronda Rousey coming off losses. So that's probably, the UFC are breathing a huge sigh of relief. Obviously, they can only afford to pay McGregor, you know, what he's worth. But right now, he's worth a hell of a lot.
Yeah, of course. We saw with Holly Holm, she returned to Albuquerque. She had a massive, massive welcome home party. Yeah, before we let you go, Paul, we have to ask you, what do you think the welcome home parade will be like when McGregor comes back to Ireland?
Yeah, it's going to be interesting to see what Conor's plans are, because when he came back after winning the interim featherweight title, it was about 6 weeks after he'd beaten Chad Mendes. So the hype of the victory had kind of died down at that point, and he kind of slipped in quietly to Dublin without much of fanfare. But if he wants to make a big deal of this, it'll be pretty big. You know, it goes back to what I was saying earlier on about Irish people. When there's an athlete who's the best in the world in their particular field, they'll really get behind him, and the whole country is behind him now at this stage. Even the people who, as I mentioned, the kind of detractors and the doubters, they're finally starting to come around and appreciate what this guy is capable of and the supreme talent that he has. If Conor wants this to be big, it'll be massive, but I guess it'll come down to whether he wants to slip in quietly on Christmas week, you know, and have a few days with his family, or whether he wants to make the most of it and get the celebration started.
Yeah, well, it's good times in MMA if you're Conor McGregor. Guys, you can catch Paul on Twitter at Paul Dollery, and make sure to catch his articles on The 42. It's always a great read. We really appreciate the insight. Thanks so much for coming to the show, Paul.
Thanks for having me on, guys, and keep up the good work.
Hey, guys, this is Frankie Edgar, and you're listening to Submission Radio.
And there you go, guys. Paul Dollery of the 42. We hope you enjoyed that. Obviously, getting some great insight from one of Ireland's own. It wasn't just a massive week or a few days for MMA fans, but it was a massive, event for Ireland in general, really putting them on the map. So it was fantastic to get some insight from Paul himself and one of Ireland's own. Now, before we dive into our breakdown, we wanted to take a moment to do something fun. And so our next guest has been kind enough to return to Submission Radio, make a quick appearance to give his take on the massive weekend that just transpired. He makes us laugh all the time with his hilarious videos, and he's going to give us a taste right now. Tommy Toehold, welcome back to the show. It's great to have you here.
Thank you for having me, guys. I hope to one day be allowed to enter Australia again legally. Fight fans, the UFC had the biggest fucking weekend in the history of weekends, filled with people punching each other in the face for money and punching each other in the dick on accident. There were so many fights, so many moments, but these are the top five best moments as voted on by me, which means they're right. Fuck what anybody else likes. The number five moment is when the tough fights ended and there were no more tough fights. Holy shit. It was just nice knowing that for the rest of the weekend, I wasn't going to be seeing strangely mismatched shorts, 30-minute long promos on fighters I don't know or care about, and a fight where a guy wore another guy as a backpack and they just kind of chilled like they were stuck in a very, very small elevator. The number four moment, Tony Ferguson simply not giving one goddamn fuck about the fact that he is a human being who has to abide by the laws of physics. I'll be honest with you, I don't know what 95% of that shit is that he's doing, but it clearly works because Edson Barboza looked like somebody kickstarted a wood chipper in his face. Tony Ferguson, keep playing life like it's a video game. The number three moment of the weekend was Sage Northcutt existing. To the chagrin of millions of fucked up people who are hoping this kid is just as fucked up as them, Sage Northcutt has accomplished more since I started this sentence than I have in my entire adult life. And for reminding me of that failure while doing cool flips and looking like a cartoon character, I salute him. The number two moment of the weekend was Luke Rockhold having a second chance to stop spinning shit from ruining his life and capitalizing on it. Honestly, I don't know if Luke was going to win that fight before that fucking shit came, but as soon as there were spinning head kicks in play, his rage over Vitor kicked in, and he went full Edward Norton versus the Joker in Fight Club on Chris Weidman. It was fucking magical. It was like a unicorn made of chocolate chip cookies. And the number one moment is, of course, the reaction of the internet to Conor McGregor ghosting Jose Aldo in less time than you can warm up a burrito safely. This fucking guy makes people so salty and makes another group of people so goddamn insane so as to burn Las Vegas to the ground out of pure joy that whenever he does anything, it is magic to just sit back and watch the world absolutely lose its mind like that scene in The Church in Kingsman where everybody kills the shit out of each other. That scene is Conor McGregor incarnate. That's what the fuck I got from this weekend, but stick around because some actually legitimate people are going to break this shit down for you right after this.
What's up, guys? This is Urijah Faber, the California Kid, and you're listening to Submission Radio.
That was the hilarious Tommy Toehold. As always, we appreciate Tommy coming on the show, sharing some of the goodness on Submission Radio. Very kind of him to call us legitimate. You're too kind, Tommy. Speaking of legitimate, Tommy also has his own podcast, Bushido Talk, where he talks a little bit more serious about things. It's on soundcloud.com/Bushido Talk. He's also got a random podcast, Lowdown Random Thoughts. That's soundcloud.com/Lowdown Random. Obviously, follow him on Twitter at Tommy Toehold and Facebook, facebook.com/Tommy Toehold. And if you do want to buy some stuff like t-shirts, geese, patches, and beanies, and other stuff with his face on it, TripleTHS.com. But, Dennis, I believe I'm not the only one who thinks it's time to get cracking and get stuck into this main meal, so to speak.
As we mentioned in the intro, a crazy weekend in MMA, and we thought long and hard, me and Kacper, how do we tackle this? How do we break down the topics of a crazy, crazy weekend, possibly one of the craziest weekends in MMA? We couldn't do it alone. The two men we needed to enlist the help of. The first, Kirik Jenness from the underground, mixedmartialarts.com, MMA.tv, a pioneer when it comes to websites. Kirik, welcome to the program. And also, Duane Finley, who you guys may know from his awesome content following Carlos Condit around leading into his fight. We'll talk about that a bit later. He also obviously writes for UFC.com, Fansided, Sports Illustrated. Yeah, he's a novelist. And he is a previous guest on Submission Radio as well. Duane, thank you for coming on the show as well. Thanks for joining us, guys.
Huge pleasure and honor to be here. Very grateful for it.
All right. Well, Duane doesn't feel the same way, it seems like.
Yeah, of course I don't feel that way. I mean, come on, it's my Sunday. No, it's always an honor talking with you, gents. You guys kick ass. So, yeah, let's do it.
Yeah, our excuse is it's Monday here in Australia. So, no Sunday excuses, fellas. But yeah. Before we get into UFC 194, let's get into some of the key fights from the two previous events over last weekend for us here in Australia. At UFC Fight Night 80, Sage Northcutt enjoyed a victory over Cody. It was a good performance. The real interest was in his post-fight promo where he told people to Google John 3:16 and at the post-fight presser where he gave perfectly structured PR answers. Some people have found Sage's answers a little fake and annoying. I'd like to go around the panel and get people's thoughts on the persona that is Sage Northcutt. Kirik, we'll go with you first, followed by you, Duane, and then you, Kacper. Let us know, Kirik, what do you think about this kid?
I think he's excellent. I've reffed a fair amount in Texas. I probably reffed there a couple of dozen times, and he's a great representation of the state. He definitely is media savvy. I think you have to be in this day and age if you want to make it to the top of the sport, and he and his father are bright enough to know that. His father's been involved in martial arts for, I think, his entire lifetime, and I suppose he does come across as being packaged to some extent, but unfortunately, that's what you have to do. A perfectly reasonable, normal human being who gets thrown into sort of the modern media can come off as being a complete idiot when they're not. Just because media finds idiocy more interesting than somebody being normal. So he does speak very, very cautiously, very carefully. He's clearly been coached to do that. But I think given the milieu that we all swim in, it's what he has to do. And I think he does a good job of it. I'm proud to be in a sport that he's prominent in.
Duane, let me ask you, because it's one of those cases where you see a guy like John Jones who was giving a lot of PR savvy answers earlier on in his career. What do you think of the Sage Northcutt persona? And also, do you think it will change as time goes on in the UFC?
Yeah, you know, there's no doubting that this kid's talented. And, you know, we have this, especially on the American side of things, we have this, you know, we love to eat our own. You know what I mean? Mm. Like, we build you up and then we tear you down. Ronda's experiencing this, you know, kind of as we speak. You know, Sage, you know, he kind of makes my brain hurt a little bit. You know, I get the prepackaged answers, the stock answers, but I thought like the Fight Pass plug, like, mm-hmm. Gee gosh, I'm so happy to be fighting on Fight Pass. Come on, man. Like, I mean, let some of it go and put a shirt on because he's making the rest of us dad bodders, you know, kind of look bad. But, I think if you're alluding to, like, you know, is there like a rise and then a fall? Is there going to be cracks, you know, that show like John Jones when he gave these stock answers? And, the, you know, that's for the future to determine. But Kirik is absolutely right that his father's very savvy. He's obviously been conditioned to be he's ready for the spotlight. He's ready for the main stage. He's ready to this media persona, but you know, with how we work, man, we'll be looking for those cracks, and surely enough, you know there'll be, we'll find out. Like, well, I think Anik made the joke that he doesn't use the internet, and then, you know, it's like, there's some, you know, kind of like Rory McDonald in the whole like darknet thing, you know, there's always gonna be like, man, this guy, there's no way this guy's like this in real life. So, you know, it'll be interesting to ride to see that ride, but I do think talented wise inside the octagon, man, the kid's going to be something special to watch.
For sure. And just on his persona, the comparisons to John Jones, I think from the onset with John Jones, we kind of saw that there may have been another side to him. On one hand, he's sort of talking like he's sort of Bruce Lee and being very philosophical. On the other side, you know, way before he was, you know, having the beef and having the trash talk with Daniel Cormier, you just saw there was another side to him. With Sage Northcutt, I believe that that's just the way he is, and sometimes the way he tries to come off is a little bit clumsy, like with the Fight Pass plug, that was pretty nauseating, but I do believe that as a 19-year-old kid, he's just one of those guys that's sort of been raised right, and I don't know how different he would be. Kirik, I don't know if you have any insight, because obviously you've reffed there, but I imagine that that's just the way he is in real life, and I think, you know, when you're young, you do tend to care a lot more about what people think, and I think I imagine you would agree, as you get older, you just don't really give a shit anymore what people think, and you sort of start realizing that, you know what, there's only one life, and I'm not going to spend it worrying about what other people think. So I think as Sage gets a little bit older, we're probably going to see more and more from him, just in terms of personality. But at 19 years old, he's still, I guess, looking up to his elders and sort of being sort of yes sir, no sir. And I think as time goes by, he might let go of that a little bit. Dennis, what do you think?
Well, I'll tell you something, guys. If I was like Sage when I was 19 years old, I'd probably be a lot richer and have a lot more jobs and a lot more people would like me. But it's interesting to see him do what he's doing right now. I think in the future we will see more from Sage, but he's sort of dipping his toe in the water. Yeah, it is a little bit nauseating for me to watch. And as a media member, I do want to get his real thoughts on stuff. So I'm hoping we get there. But what else happened on the card that amazed people was Rose's dominating performance in the main event of the card. Fans were impressed with Rose's domination, but it also looked like they were even more impressed with the toughness that Paige displayed in the fight. Even though Paige had lost to the fight, she lost it in a way that, you know, a lot of people think her stock has risen with fans who maybe thought she was getting privileges with the UFC because of her looks. I'm going to go over to you first, Kirik. What's next for Rose, and do you think that Paige's stock has risen even though she's lost in this fight?
Rose is a longtime member of the UG, and from everything I've met her maybe once, but from everything I've heard from people who know her, she's a really a wonderful human being, and did not have an easy childhood, and deserves everything she gets from the sport. And people don't usually get very much from the sport, so I hope she gets a title shot from it. Paige VanZant, because of her looks, has received a lot of benefits that a less mediagenic person wouldn't have, and you can't blame her for that. A lot of fans are sort of down on her for that. She only got it because she's a model, and there is some truth to that. But Christ Almighty, it's not her fault. She's good looking, mm-hmm. And I don't know what kind of a person is sort of down on her for that. And the bottom line is, in this sport, if you don't keep winning, all the benefits go away. So it sort of self-selects against it anyways. And she did. She quitted herself really well. She's young, and I expect big things are going to happen for her too. But I hope they happen really fast for Rose.
Well, I mean, you just heard it, Duane. Kirik wants Rose to have a title shot. A lot of people think that Claudia Gadelha should be the next title shot, and possibly Rose gets a rematch with Tisha Torres. What do you think? What's next for Rose? And also, has Paige's stock risen?
Before I move on to that, I got this thought in my head. You talking about the John Jones thing. I'm like, I see Paige, Sage Northcutt going, "Hey, are you still there, pussy?" Okay, on to the Rose. Let me tell you why I thought this matchup was fascinating on a lot of fronts. I mean, anybody who's followed Rose knows that she struggled with the spotlight that was put on her and the expectation that was put on her after coming off the Ultimate Fighter. You know, she took that train wreck at the hands of Esparza, and she, you know, she recoiled back and got her things together, you know, and she came back focused. You know, this was what's so interesting about the dynamic in this fight between Rose and Paige was that it was like, you know, a year ago, this is where Rose was. Is Paige ready for the prime time? And what we saw was that, no, she wasn't quite ready. That Rose, you know, the new dystopian Fury Road, Rose Namajunas look. She came out and wrecked shop. So what I would like to see is, I personally think Gadelha should get the title shot versus Joanna Champion. I'd love to see those two run that back and then give Rose Tisha Torres. Tisha looked awesome. Rose looked great. You know, they just fought a night apart, you know, same timelines. And that'd be a great fight. And it'd be another highlight fight for that women's strawweight division. As far as Paige's stock, yeah, it's not going to hurt. She didn't fold up, man. Like she took that beating like a veteran, and she's not. I think that was like her sixth or whatever, and you know, it's, yeah, her looks are her looks, and that's not gonna go anywhere soon. But did you guys get that feeling like it was like the chick from you know, and no disrespect, but using the word chick, but it was like the girl from high school that's gotten like that was cool, but from the other side of the tracks, who like smoked Marlboro Reds and wore like a jean jacket versus the cheerleader, like the rumors, like then they finally met at the bike rack and did it up, you know, it had that feel to it for me. But I'm interested to see where both of them go.
Yeah, no, I completely agree. I think a lot of people saw it like that as well. And just the thing with on Paige VanZant, I don't think MMA fans really like good-looking people. I think they sort of immediately see it as a weakness, and I think they're sort of looking to take something from those people. And I think with Paige VanZant, especially, it didn't really help the fact that she used to be a model, and people automatically question, well, how much of a fighter is she really? Is she really just a good-looking person who somehow found their way into MMA? And I think had she sort of gone through that fight, we saw she got busted open, she was bleeding all over the place. Had she gone into that fight and looked like she was worried about the damage that she was taking, and that's the other thing, there was a lot of times where she could have, you know, found a way out of that fight. There was arm bars that were very close, there was a choke that was very close, she probably could have gotten TKO'd as well. But the fact that she kept pushing, a lot of people respect that. A lot of people thought, wow, she's not just a model. She clearly has thrown complete disregard to her looks. I mean, you know, if you're a model and you're covered in scars, it's not exactly a plus on the resume. And she appeared as if she completely didn't care. So a lot of people found that very admirable. Blown away by Paige VanZant. Obviously, Rose herself put on a fantastic performance and really outclassed and dismantled Paige. Again, Paige being so young, the ceiling is so high for her. So I'm excited to see what's next for both of them. But yeah, I'm going to agree with you, Duane, that I do think Tisha Torres versus Rose is the next logical matchup. I think there's a story enough to see Claudia Gadea versus Joanna Jędrzejczyk. So I'd rather the fights play out like that. What about you, Dennis?
Yeah, it's one of those things where She's gone through the burner, and much like Rocky, she's come out the other side. And I think a lot of fans have some newfound respect for her. And it's also one of those things where, you know, it's a reality check. She is where she is, and she's got some skills that she needs to improve. And hopefully the UFC understand that, give her some matchups where she can get some more experience before they throw her back in the octagon with someone like Rose. But yeah, it's a whole lot of respect earned around the world for Paige. And yeah, that Tisha Torres match would be great. It would be great to see those two guys go at it. Also from the perspective of keeping a good contender in the division and building them up for that potential fight with Joanna if she does beat Claudia Gadelha. But jumping over to the tough finale, guys, there were some disappointing performances from the likes of Gabriel Gonzaga, a strange finale win for Ryan Hall. But Tony Ferguson is a guy who's been sneaking under the radar for a while. He, of course, won by submission in the second round. My question to you, Kirik, is what's next for Ferguson and who should he fight next?
I don't want to step into Joe Silva's shoes, but mm-hmm. I do want to give just a huge shout out to that scramble at the end. That bloody scramble was, I think it's not just the best scramble I've seen this year. That was the best scramble that I've seen in years and years and years. And any fight worth having is going to be won in that scramble. If a guy smashes the other guy or he gets smashed, usually it's because there was poor matchmaking. Anytime you get good, solid matchmaking, the fight isn't won in the perfect 1-2 into a double leg, into an elbow. It's won in those crazy little scrambles. And that slippery, bleeding scramble was just the most beautiful thing that I've seen in sports, I think, in this entire year. Wow. There's a saying that the sport is built on three words, holy fucking shit. And that's what I was screaming during that final scramble. I'm shaking thinking about it. I'm so excited. And the other thing I want to say about that card is I think we're starting to see jiu-jitsu coming back. I've been reffing since the 90s, and particularly in grappling tournaments, you'd see new moves start. I remember when heel hooks came in, people didn't know them and they'd spin the wrong way and their leg would break. And then the front headlock started to come in as a one-arm guillotine and people would be getting put to sleep. And then jiu-jitsu slowly just disappeared from MMA. And I feel like it's starting to come back now. That scramble was incredible. Ryan Hall's jiu-jitsu was mind-boggling to me. And that's the two biggest things that screamed at me from that event are a little return of jiu-jitsu and that beautiful bloody scramble.
What do you think, though, next for Ferguson, Kirik? Do you want to see him get someone right up there in the division? Who would you like to see him fight next?
God, I couldn't put a name to it. You know, I'm the records keeper for the sport, but as far as the matchmaking goes, I just leave that up to Joe Silva, and he seems to always do a good job.
That's right. Well, we don't have Joe Silva on the phone, but we do have Duane Finley, who in a lot of ways is the second best thing. Duane, what do you think? Who should Tony Ferguson fight next? I mean, you made a comparison between the two sides of the tracks, between Paige and Rose. What do you think for Tony? Obviously, Tony bringing up his trash-talking game leading into the fight, you know, spitting a lot of fire. I mean, this guy is marketable. He can really sell a fight. Who do you want to see him fight next?
Well, you know, I can't fill Joe's shoes. I definitely am more handsome than Joe, so I'll go for it. I would love to see Tony fight the winner of Pettis versus Alvarez. They fight in Boston. There's no reason to slow this kid down. Just like Kirik said, I think Tony should seriously consider changing that nickname to Tony Protect Your Neck Ferguson or Wu-Tang. Yeah. You know what I mean? That was just insane. And you know what was funny is I had never really seen, like, in those back-to-back fights or whatever, Ryan Hall and Tony Ferguson rolling in, you know, for those legs like that. That was, you know, amazing. And like, I do agree with Kirik that we're seeing this strange kind of renaissance of jiu-jitsu come back. And I love it because it keeps things more complex. And it's funny. It's mostly the eras of like simplicity. Like now we see guys, how many times in that 3-day stretch of fights did we see long stretches of back control where guys were safe? You know, they didn't get choked out, you know. 7 years ago, those guys are going to sleep in 15 minutes. But now everybody knows how to, you know, how to defend it. So I think it's great, and I think it's only going to get better. But the reason I say with Pettis and the winner of Pettis Alvarez is Ferguson's right there, and he's, you know, what is he like 9-1 now in the UFC or 10-1, and there's no reason to slow him down at all. I say, you know, he was booked for Khabib, and Khabib got hurt. Why take a step back? Showtime versus Eddie. They fight in January. Let the winner go. Let Tony shot there and get in. Because, you know, if Tony fights one of those two guys, logical step is, you know, he's in title talk. So the lightweight division's so bonkers, though. I love it to death. And Tony's such a great addition to it. And he's coming into his own personality-wise, too. I love it.
Yeah, for sure. I think you may have just swayed me. I was coming into this discussion thinking Khabib Nurmagomedov, assuming that he comes back into the fighting picture and doesn't retire, just make that fight that was already going to happen. But I was looking at Eddie Alvarez, but obviously he's ranked number 4. Khabib's ranked number 3. Tony's at number 7. Edson's at number 6. But you got to think, you know, in the next few days, Tony will be at number 6. And I thought Alvarez would be a great matchup, but he's already set to face Pettis on, like you mentioned, January 17th. So I like that. Whoever wins moves forward. Tony Ferguson fights him. And whoever wins out of Tony Ferguson, the winner of Alvarez Pettis, they'd probably be looking at a title shot. Just on Tony Ferguson himself, he reminds me of that guy who everyone's kind of going to work and everyone's been at work for a while and everyone's kind of not necessarily starting to slack off, but it's just this sort of another day, another shift. Tony Ferguson's that guy. He's almost like it's his first day on the job and he's super excited. He's super keen to do everything and impress everyone. I feel like he's just a workhorse. And you mentioned those scrambles. I feel like those are opportunities that we see in a lot of fights and guys just don't capitalize. I think because a lot of people are trying to pace themselves and it's opportunities that are there, but they don't capitalize on these. And Tony Ferguson, he was really looking to capitalize on every single opportunity. You know, he went for that role when things weren't working for him, and he was just so ridiculously quick. And he does that in pretty much all of his fights. He's one of my favorite fighters on the roster to watch because he's just never in a dull fight. You know, even when he first Danny Castillo, and Danny Castillo had a very wrestling heavy game plan, Tony Ferguson made that a really, really exciting fight. You know, he puts himself on the bottom sometimes, like he did in that fight, and he still finds a way to win. So I absolutely love the guy, and I hope. And, you know, he did an interview with Errol Helwani. He was, like you mentioned, in a spit and fire, calling out people, calling out Conor McGregor, calling out everybody. So I definitely think he will be having a title shot in 2016.
Wearing sunglasses indoors, though, fellas. I don't know if that's a good thing, but
it's a very Vin Diesel thing to do.
It's very Vin Diesel-ish. But for those that don't know, Tony actually used to work in marketing and sales during the day and picked up shifts as a bartender at night.
Wow.
One night while he was bartending, a patron talked to him about his wrestling background and invited him to work with some young MMA fighters with their wrestling. And then Ferguson immediately fell in love with the sport and hasn't looked back since. So I don't know, fellas, do we need to find that patron and thank him for approaching Ferguson in that bar, or is that a bit strange?
That's highly deserved. I would, I'd serve that guy beers for the evening.
Speaking of evenings, and that's a very nice segue there onto the main event of the tough finale between Chad Mendes and Frankie Edgar. I mean, what can be said about this one, fellas? Frankie Edgar going out there and showing us that age is not a number and he just keeps getting better with it. Kirik, I want to get your thoughts on the fight. It was a quick one. Did it go the way that you thought? And how impressed are you with Frankie Edgar and his performance?
I've been impressed with Frankie Edgar, Christ almighty, since before the UFC, certainly. I did think he was going to win that fight. I didn't think that he was going to kind of turn in the hook quite that way and smash his face. But that was a really, really exciting fight, and backed up what everybody on the East Coast of America already knew, which is that Frankie Edgar is a real force. That fight, at least from my point of view, was a little bit of an East Coast versus West Coast thing, and us East Coast people stick together a little bit, except for the Floridians, who are weird. I was really excited about that fight. It proved everything that I hope the world now knows about Frankie Edgar, which is that he's a champion.
Well, Duane, Frankie Edgar comes off another dominant win. Surely this spells a title shot against McGregor for him. Is there a chance somehow Edgar misses out on a title shot yet again, especially with McGregor wanting to have a fight at lightweight?
No, I really don't. I think it's overdue and it's time. I think that he gets it. I think they do McGregor versus Edgar next. I don't think there's any reason to throw Jose right back in there. And 13-second knockout aside, like, it's the fact that so much mental. Like, I don't agree with the Rousey home rematch either. I think, like, you know, you just got to take this time off and unplug and let Jose get back to being Jose and without the pressure of this fight, and then let him work his way back up. And that's exactly what I think the problem with Chad Mendes was. That's why I picked Edgar so outright in this fight, because for one, Frankie's fighting like he's 22 years old. And that's a credit to Mark Henry, the mad genius at the Iron Army over there. Frankie's moving. He's not taking that damage like he took at 55. And if you look at the fights against BJ Penn, Oliveira, Swanson, you know, Mendes, these are just like clean sweeps. He's not taking the, it's not the Rocky story that it once was. Edgar's a monster right now. Nobody wants, see, and Mendes was that guy that nobody wanted to see, but Edgar couldn't wait to get in there with him. But Chad Mendes, now look at this. Here's a guy who was kind of perennially the best of the rest, and now he's lost three of his last four. They were all huge fights, but getting knocked out by McGregor, and then coming back and then fighting Edgar, I didn't think it made sense. I thought they should did Holloway Edgar, and I thought that should have produced the next contender, but they didn't. They went with Mendes. And now look at Mendes. He's probably, you know, easily the second, third best 45er in the world, and now he's nowhere to go. So, do the Edgar versus McGregor. Let Frankie get his due. He's been promised a shot before, and I think with the way he performed and the way Conor performed, fans would love to see it. I think that's the one you do next.
Well, I think we have to take a second just to thank the MMA gods, just the way the fights played out the way they did over the weekend, because could you imagine if Jose Aldo won and Chad Mendes won, we'd sort of be stuck at a bit of a railroads where what do you do next? Do you do another Chad Mendes versus Jose Aldo fight? At least now we have options. Speaking of those options, you know, Conor McGregor's talking about potentially going to lightweight fighter for the title. Apparently he does have that option. So I don't know. Frankie Edgar, I feel like he could have gotten a title shot quite a while ago and it would have been just. I would have been absolutely fine with it. And, you know, it's been more elusive than Anderson and Silva and Lyoto Machida combined, this title shot. Nothing would surprise me in MMA. Maybe they do a super fight. I do feel like you'd probably want to wait before you throw Conor McGregor to lightweight, and you'd really want to squeeze as much as you can from his featherweight run. So I do have a feeling Frankie Edgar will get the next title shot. I don't think anyone alive can really deny the fact that he does deserve it. And I think the other thing that makes this such a big victory is the fact that Chad Mendes, I think most people looked at this matchup as Frankie Edgar, he's the guy who has the more volume in strikes. Chad Mendes has the knockout power. It was Frankie Edgar who finished him. Not to say that Frankie Edgar's ever had an issue with finishing fights. Usually it happens late, and he's not known for one-punch knockout power. So this is a very, very impressive win. It's one thing to have a win and then move on to a title shot. Let's take Yoel Romero, who we'll talk about, I believe, soon. It's another thing to have a Frankie Edgar-type performance where you knock a guy clean out in the first round. I mean, that's something you can really build a story on for a title shot. So I definitely hope Frank Edgar gets that title shot. And, you know, that's a very compelling fight as well, him versus McGregor.
Just playing devil's advocate though, and listening to what Conor McGregor said during the post-fight press conference, where he said he wants to take some time off and watch some contenders fight and figure out who's going to fight him next. And listening to what Duane said, imagine if McGregor does take some time out of the division and Max Holloway gets put up against Edgar to figure out that contender. I mean, it's a crazy thought, but depending on how long it takes and the fact that Frankie Edgar is just a guy that takes all these fights, I mean, it could happen, and I hope it doesn't, because I do think Frankie Edgar deserves the next title shot. But we're talking about Conor McGregor, so let's move over to UFC 194 and a guy who opposed him in The Ultimate Fighter as the opposite coach, Urijah Faber, who also has a dressy black headband that he wears to post-fight press conferences, won yet again in an exciting fight against Frankie Saenz. If you were the UFC, it's crazy. Who do you give Faber next? Does he get the winner of Cruz Dillashaw? Does that make sense as the next fight for Faber? I'll go to you first, Kirik. What do you think?
Yeah, Faber said pretty famously now at the post-fight press conference that he and TJ Dillashaw had moved beyond friendship, and I think that backstory is going to be too strong for the UFC to resist. Mixed martial arts is not a real sport in the same way that the World Cup is, or a local kids soccer league is. It's not designed necessarily on the basis of some big tree where you start, everybody starts at the bottom and you work your way up until you get just one. It's a business, and it's in the business of making money. And I think that former student fighting the old master is going to be such a strong storyline. And there does appear to be some genuine bad blood between them now, which gets the asses in seats, that I think that is the next fight.
Duane, I mean, he also famously said in the post-fight press conference it could be a mix between Rocky 4 and 5. Hopefully it doesn't turn out as horribly as the movies did. I mean, what do you think? Do you think he gets the next person out of that matchup? And do you actually believe Sylvester Stallone left him a voicemail?
Kick his ass, Dad. He took my room. You know what? You know what's crazy about of all the greatness that is Rocky and that franchise, the one line that I cannot forget that it gets me time and time again is, you knock him down, why don't you try knocking me down now? You know, I love it. Give Sly the Oscar and see Creed. He does great in that. But anyway, yeah, with Faber, you know, I think like Kirik said, the old master versus the student kind of paradigm, I don't think we've seen that before. You know, I really don't. But here's the other thing, like kind of the caveat, so to speak, of why they have to do this. Because the rest of the Faber has been so far ahead of the pack. The rest of the pack. Yes, he struggled in title fights, but he went on that crazy, you know, streak where he never lost without a title fight. But then we see these fights that, I believe Caceres gave him some fits. Francisco Rivera some fits. Like, Urijah Faber wasn't steamrolling these guys like we've seen him do in the past. So I think unless, you know, like, you know, I don't know back to Dan Henderson. I love the guy, but, you know, Dan Henderson is the role. You know, hey, look, we need a headliner. Let's put Hendo in there. He'll fight anybody. You know, Faber's the guy, and he could be, and he probably will be that guy, unfortunately, because I just don't see him beating either Dillashaw or Cruz. But then you think about how would Urijah Faber fare against a guy like Aljamain Sterling or a guy like Thomas Almeida, and I don't think it's good, gentlemen. I don't think it's the same distance that we once saw between Faber and the rest of the guys he's in the ring with. So I think that's the easy money is this bad blood, you know. And you know what? Like, it's like Kirik said, it's weird because in some ways it's justified, though, because the bantamweight division is so jacked up right now. I mean, it's starting to kind of form at the bottom with these prospects coming up and starting to bloom, but it doesn't look like the rest of the divisions are structured. So why not give it to Faber? Let him see, you know, let him fight the winner. Either story's compelling, you know. So I'm all the way in on it.
Yeah, for sure. I think it's a win-win situation. On one hand, you've got that juicy storyline between him and TJ Dillashaw that, you know, people can't really resist. And you mentioned that the whole master versus student storyline, it's never really been done. You sort of saw shades of that with John Jones and Rashad. Obviously, that feud was a lot more bitter, but the parallels really were only that they were former trainee partners, and I think even though Rashad was in the sport longer, you never really saw it as master versus student, whereas Urijah Faber, there's the whole thing where, you know, he signed TJ Dillashaw, and, you know, he was, I guess, like a coach and like a mentor, so it is interesting, and obviously who can't resist bad blood, Kirik, like you mentioned, it's a business. Why else was Aldo McGregor so successful? Is because of the bad blood. And then let's say Dillashaw doesn't win. Let's say Dominic Cruz wins, which there's a good chance that that's going to happen. You've got that trilogy fight that never happened, that never eventuated off the Ultimate Fighter 15 that I don't feel like people were gagging for it at the time, but because they were denied it, I think people would still be pretty interested. And I think with Urijah Faber, you know, some of his recent fights, like he did have that big fight against Frankie Edgar, who was a named opponent. But before that, you had Francisco Rivera, Alex Caceres, and now Frankie Science. I think people are used to seeing Urijah Faber in big fights where he's either fighting for a title or he's beating someone who will lead him to a title. So I think people are really craving that big name opponent for Urijah Faber. Dominic Cruz fits the bill. TJ Dillashaw fits the bill. And I think people in general like seeing Urijah Faber fight for the title. And kind of like what you mentioned, Duane, I do agree that the guys below Faber, they are getting a lot better. Thomas Almeida, that's a very tough matchup. Aljamain Sterling, very tough matchup. You know, even Brian Caraway. And then above him, really, you don't have any options. You got Rafael dos Anjos, Henan Barão. I don't think anyone wants to see any of those fights. And then you've got, obviously, Dominic Cruz or TJ Dillashaw. So give him some of that low-hanging fruit, Dennis, as you like to say. Give him the Cruz fight or give him the Dillashaw fight. And now let Urijah fight for the title, even if, you know, it may very well be his last time fighting for the title.
It's definitely one of those situations where it could be a win-win. Hopefully, we'll see what happens. We have to wait till this Dillashaw-Cruz fight because I just can't get beyond it because Dillashaw's looking amazing. Cruz has amazing footwork, and that fight in itself will be a spectacle. But further up the card, guys, Gunnar Nelson suffered a defeat to Demian Maia, who I really think needs to be called Anaconda or Boa Constrictor or a snake of some kind because of his jiu-jitsu. It was another dominant performance by Maia, who's 38 years old. My question to you, Kirik, is does Maia still have a shot left in him for one last title run in the division? And if he goes up against Robbie Lawler, do you think he could beat him?
Yeah, I absolutely do. I had alluded earlier to the fact that I think jiu-jitsu is making a renaissance in the sport. Obviously, the big hole has been takedowns, but Demian Maia has these crazy leg trips up against the fence at a higher level, I believe, easily than anyone else in the entire sport. I don't know where he picked them up from. I don't know exactly where they come from. But once he gets somebody pinned up against the cage wall, he's as good as anybody I've ever seen. In fact, he's better than anybody I've ever seen at using his legs to get the other person down. That gets you on the floor. And his jiu-jitsu is incredible. Watching him, he would tap me just with his hips. I mean, I'm not great or anything, but watching the pressure that he was putting on Gunnar was mind-boggling to me. When he sunk those hips down, it was like there was extra gravity there, and he was doing jiu-jitsu on Jupiter or something. So I think absolutely he a title shot would make sense, and I think he has a chance of winning it. He would get close, get things to the cage wall, do a leg trip, and then work his Jupiter gravity jiu-jitsu to title winning effect.
What do you think, Duane? Jupiter jiu-jitsu, do you think it gets Lawler? Do you think he could beat him? Do you think he has one last title shot left in him?
You know, I don't know if Damian gets that far up again. And it's always just a weird stylistic matchup that does him in. And, you know, because he dominates. But it's almost like we don't need him. And I don't think he needs to fight for a title. I think he just enjoys what he does. You know, he loves to fight. He loves fighting his way. And we're to really appreciate that. And that's what I love about it. Because you remember when he first came to the UFC, everybody, you know, his style's boring and it's, you know, he needs to be more exciting. And then he starts entertaining the fact that he can fight on his feet. And then Nate Marquardt happens, you know, Anderson Silva happens. And then he drops down to 170 and goes back to Demian Maia, the guy we love. So yeah, you know what? I think on any given night, Demian Maia can beat anybody in that division. Just depends, you know, just depends what happens. You know, can he wrap up a guy like Lawler? Absolutely. Would he fare so well against a guy like Condit, who's pretty slick on the ground? I think, you know, we saw against a guy like Gunnar Nelson. I mean, he gave Gunnar a master class in jiu-jitsu last night. So, yeah, I think put Demian Maia against anybody. I just don't know. It's always he always just has that one misstep here and there. And that's, of course, you know, like I said, he's almost 40. So, you know, I think he's got – Damian could do whatever he wants. I just don't know how bad he wants anything right now.
Well, Damian's not a fan of the rankings. Above him, he's at number 6, by the way. Above him, you've got Matt Brown, Carlos Condit, John Hendricks, Tyron Woodley, Rory McDonald, and Robbie Lawler. Those are all pretty tough matchups. So I definitely see your point, Duane about how will he even make it to a title shot. If he does, I mean, Robbie Lawler, he's struggled in the past against guys like Jacare and Jake Shields. So it's definitely something that you can see Demian Maia submitting him. I do also think that Robbie Lawler has improved a vast amount, especially on his takedown defense since those fights. I think Robbie would definitely be the tougher matchup, just because with Carlos Condit, he's a fantastic, amazing fighter. The only knock on him has always been his wrestling. We saw Martin Campman, who's a guy who was always very well-rounded, but not necessarily known for his wrestling, not necessarily an elite wrestler, and he took him down multiple times until he sort of faded later in the round. So to see Demian Maia do that to Carlos Condit, I can absolutely see it. And again, with Robbie Lawler, Kirik, like you mentioned, it's not always about the double leg. If he does get him at the legs and if he does trip him, I could see him having potentially a field day against Robbie Lawler. So it all really depends on whether he does make it to a title shot, but I do feel like he's been in the sport for so long. Yes, he had that title shot against Anderson Silva. He's a much, much better fighter than he was then, so I wouldn't mind seeing Demian Maia get a title shot.
And I'm also very interested, because I know Johnny Hendricks is fighting Stephen Wonderboy Thompson next, but I'd love to see how he fares against Johnny Hendricks, in the sense that what's going to happen if Johnny Hendricks tries to take him down. Because when you go on the ground with Demian Maia, it's danger. Does that cancel out one of Hendricks's biggest weapons? Even though he does have some powerful striking, he has gone to that wrestling a lot to win fights for him. So very interested to see if that fight could come together. But yeah, certainly at 38 years old, in a set of hair like he has, I mean, that's some silky smooth hair bouncing back and forth as he fights. I mean, the guy has it all going for him. And sky's the limit for Demian Maia. And it's great to see that he's able to go into some of the gaps that he had previously and tighten up those areas so he can use his jiu-jitsu even more effectively. So, I mean, some of those takedowns, like you fellas mentioned, it just makes everybody want to go back to their MMA school and stop doing the double legs and start focusing on those Demian Maia takedowns. They're just beautiful. But further up the card, Yoel Romero edged out Jacare in what seemed like, to a lot of people, a middleweight title eliminator. Now, I personally, fellas, had Jacare winning the second and third round in that fight. So I'm going to go to you first, Kirik. Were you surprised by the decision? Did you think that Yoel Romero won it?
I did think that Yoel Romero won it. I wanted Jacare to win. I think he's a more exciting fighter. I like his skill set better. But I don't think he won that fight. I think that Yoel, in a five-round fight, is going to have a really, really, really hard time. The first round he came out and he looked, as he always did, just barely human. His level change into a leg shot is just ridiculous. It doesn't look human to my eye. But you know, then he starts huffing and puffing and he looks all too human, and I just can't see him in a five round fight. And for that reason, I don't think he's a great candidate for a title shot. The fight I'd like to see is Luke Rockhold versus Lyoto Machida. He said, you know, they asked him, what do you want? And he said, it's Lyoto Machida, Vitor Belfort. He said, I want Vitor Belfort on a silver platter. And he put on a great fight versus Weidman. It was so definitive. I don't think there needs to be an immediate rematch. He's the champ. I think what the champ wants should take some precedence, and so I really want to see him fight Vitor Belfort. And of course, this time it's going to be a TRT free Belfort, which could be a very different story than the first one.
Duane, Kirik mentioned the silver platter. Does this mean Yoel Romero is going to be the appetizer, or do you think that Luke Rockhold? Do you agree? Do you think that Luke Rockhold should fight Vitor Belfort next?
I was with Rockhold about 2 months after the Belfort fight, and man, I've rarely seen a fighter so disturbed by a loss. I mean, if you cover the sport any amount of time, you know, you talk to guys when they win, you talk to guys when they lose, there's always going to be kind of that sting there. But man, that Rockhold was really just Belfort thing just hasn't left him at all. And yeah, so I think unfair to throw in the Romero, to jump Romero and push him out of the shot, especially after beating a tough guy like Jacare, who nobody else wanted to fight. But like Kirik said a little while ago, this is a business, and Belfort's a old dinosaur, as he likes to say, or a young dinosaur, or a Jesus lion. I'm not sure which one. But and how many more miles do you have on those tires? You know, especially now that they're not extra inflated. you know, rim shot. Like,
nice, nice. That was good.
Nice,
that was
nice good. Stick there from the American kid.
Yeah.
But yeah, I think, you know, there's no reason to do the Weidman fight. There's no reason on that back, man. Like, give Weidman some time. That was ugly. Let Rockhold, you know, get Belfort. Do it, you know. I think they could probably, you know, do it in summer. You know, do a big card in the summer and let Rockhold defend, because 85 is in this weird place right now.
It is in a bit of a weird place. We spoke about it before the show, how Romero and Jacare was definitely a title eliminator, and they seem to sort of tiptoe around that fact. Nothing was announced. Obviously, they don't announce fights on Fight Night, but it's almost as if the UFC saw that this could potentially happen. I would have rather to see Jacare get the win, and I don't know, with this one, I did see Jacare winning, but really, that second round was so close. I don't think it was a robbery like a lot of people think, and, you know, it was a win, but I don't know if you can really call it that much of an impressive win. It is impressive in the sense that to beat Jacare is a lot, but it was close, and I guess I'm sort of, I don't want to take anything away from either fighter, I'm just more sort of forward thinking in the sense that it was impressive, but it's not the kind of fight we look at it and think, wow, that's a genuine threat to the title. I saw that fight and I thought, if Romero goes up against Rockhold, it's probably not going to be very pretty. You know, Romero may have his moments in the first round or the second round, but and Rockhold said as much when they asked him about what he thought about Romero's victory. He sort of didn't want to say much, and he said, I like Romero. You know, he's a good guy. That fight's going to happen. But I think what he was really thinking was, and I think he even said as much that, you know, if they fought, he really needs to work on his cardio because it's not going to be a good night for him. As far as Luke Rockhold, I don't know how much he wants Vitor Belfort, though, because when he was asked about that question, he sort of, he didn't necessarily say he wants Vitor Belfort. He just said Vitor Belfort on a silver platter. You know, that'd be nice. I think what he's getting at is that in a rematch, he'd beat him very handily. And to be honest with you, I'm more interested in seeing that rematch than I would be against Yoel Romero, because I wouldn't give Romero much of a chance against Rockhold.
Kirik, well, you brought up the Vitor Belfort thing initially. Let me ask you, let's talk about the Rockhold-Weidman fight. Herb Dean didn't stop the fight in the third round, even though Rockhold was mounted on top of Weidman, throwing down elbows. What did you think? A lot of people thought the fight should have been stopped at that point. Do you think the fight went too long, and did you think it should have been stopped?
I don't. I've reffed hundreds of MMA fights. I'm not anywhere near close to the level Herb Dean is. Herb Dean is one of the two best refs in the sport. I thought he played that absolutely perfectly. I think that over and over and over again, it was a split second from ending the fight, but I don't think you take it away from the champion on the basis of that. What you look for when you ref is a very, very hard to define thing, but it's very easy when you see it. You look for when the guy no longer wants to be in there. At some point, the guy just sort of curls up and gives up. He doesn't want to be in the fight anymore. And I did not see that in the third round. Although Weidman was moving very little and was grimacing and was bleeding from five or six different places, it did not look to me like he didn't want to be in the fight anymore. And for that reason, I think, despite what Dana said about it, I think it was brilliant, brilliant refereeing.
While we're on the topic of refereeing, there was a weird part in the fight where Rockhold had sort of a guillotine. He didn't have his legs in the right place, but Herb Dean stood them up. I myself didn't think it made sense for them to be stood up, but I'm not a referee. Want to get your perspective, Kirik. What did you think of that part of the fight?
I never want to second guess referees, because you see a lot of things that you can't see on TV. I've had fights that were absolutely unbelievable from the referee's point of view. Guys are just smashing each other and blood's flying everywhere. And you look at it from a TV camera and it didn't look like anything happened. It looked like kind of a boring average fight. When I saw it, I was kind of shocked. I thought at the time maybe there was some communication between Rockhold and Herb, and somehow Rockhold was saying, yeah, it's fine to stand us up. It did baffle me. I don't have an explanation for it, but I'm not qualified to contradict or criticize Herb Dean either.
Well, speaking of baffling, I mean, Rockhold's performance was amazing, and he then reveals he had an infection. He was on antibiotics a day before the weigh-ins. He was still able to do what he did against Weidman. Duane, your thoughts on Rockhold's performance, and what does this mean for Weidman? Where does this put him?
Rockhold's performances was fantastic. Just, and you could tell, fighters, no fighter goes through the rigors of a camp and comes in 100%. But you could, Rockhold's cardio has never been in question. You could see him zap in that second round, you could see him fighting it, But, they always say, cliche aside, the championship mentality, and that's what he had, man. He battled through. And I agree with Kirik again that I don't think that the fight should have been stopped. I mean, Herb Dean was right on top of it. He let the champ fight it out, man. Let the champ, don't take it away from him like that. Let the champ go out on the field. And then that's why, you notice he was so quick to stop it up against the cage in the next round, because he just saw that whatever he saw that was there in the third wasn't there in the fourth with Chris. You know what I'm saying? So, it was fantastic. And Rockhold's such a strange style matchup for anybody in that division. You think that Weidman had done so well, I guess the second one you can't count, but, had done so well against Anderson Silva being a southpaw and such a lethal striker. And then Weidman just kind of lumbered last night, and then he's not going to live down that failed wheel kick attempt anytime soon.
Yeah.
But, I just don't get it. It just didn't look like the normal Chris Weidman. And maybe that's what we learned this week, is that some of these guys who've been at the top for a little bit need to kind of cycle back, and maybe it's the UFC PR machine a little bit, even though that Weidman isn't really pushed like that because he's, his personality or whatnot. But I think Weidman falls back, and then why not, if he's super hungry and he's eager to get back, let him fight Jacare. They're both coming off losses. That'd be a great fight. Otherwise, I think you just kind of go back and the way it used to be done, where, all these immediate rematches are bullshit. Let it go. Let the next guy get his. Let the old champ cycle back. Let him fight his way back up, Mendes style, and get it. And I think Chris will be better off if he works that way.
Yeah, I agree with you, Duane, on the whole rematch situation, because you get things like with Cain Velasquez, where, he fights for a few years and he's only fought two opponents in Bigfoot Silva in June Dos Santos, and you just want to see something fresh. And I think that can sort of be said for a lot of the fights on this card. Just a few notes on these fights. I mean, was it just me, or when you saw Rockhold versus Weidman, it looked like a separate weight class, like there were two weight class, or one weight class apart? Weidman, usually known for a massive weight cut, this time I think he only cut like 7 pounds as opposed to the usual 20. He looked so much smaller, and Rockhold just looked absolutely massive. Going into this fight, I thought that if anyone had a cardio advantage, it was going to be Rockhold, and it seemed apparent that he didn't have that advantage. And obviously, I'm glad that we found out he was sick, because if that was 100% Rockhold, I'd be worried about the future. Just an absolutely fantastic performance on that stoppage. When I watched it in real time, I did think it should have been stopped, just purely because we have seen fights stopped, in my opinion, for a lot less. But Kirik, I absolutely respect the fact that I have never refereed a fight in my life, and you have refereed multiple, so I completely respect you in that sense. I'll take your word for it. Just with that guillotine, if you watch that fight, I think there was communication with Rockhold. He sort of looked at Herb Dean, he sort of said something, or he nodded. I don't think fighters should ever dictate what happens in a fight, but I think it was just understood. Anyone who's trained BJJ understands sometimes you're going for a takedown, someone gets you in a guillotine, you go to side control, they can't finish it, but you may not necessarily be able to pass. You're kind of stuck in a stalemate. It's an annoying situation. So I actually do think it was the right thing to do, because Rockhold wasn't going to go for the finish, and I think Weidman was just sort of stuck there. So I don't have an issue with that guillotine. And yeah, I can't tell, to sort of wrap this up, I can't tell you how impressed I am with Luke Rockhold. And if you go on the comment section on some of our YouTube videos, we did pick it, Luke Rockhold TKO in round 3 or 4. So pretty happy that we got that correct. It was like Kasper, the only thing we got right.
Kasper's been reminding this to people wherever he could over the last whatever amount of hours since it's happened. So everybody who's going to see Kasper throughout the next couple of weeks, be prepared for the reminder. But I'm just going to jump over to the main event, guys. I mean, UFC 194, by the way, fantastic event from the prelims to the main card. Just, you couldn't ask for more. It was fantastic. It lived up to the hype that the fans expected. And, we'll talk about this in a second, but I mean, possibly one of the best, possibly one of the cards of all time, best cards of all time for the UFC. But let's talk about the McGregor-Aldo fight. The entrance saw a pretty confident McGregor. In comparison, Aldo looked a little stressed. He kept his head down, but he usually does that. So I'm going to go to you first, Kirik. Do you think the pressure got to Aldo in this fight? Did you see any indications that he was emotional in any way at the beginning of the fight with McGregor?
Yeah, I do. I think Conor McGregor does a better job of getting into people's heads of anybody since Muhammad Ali. I mean, Muhammad Ali just tortured Joe Frazier by making him out to be the white man's choice. Mm-hmm. And Joe Frazier kind of plaintively said, you know, dude, my wife's black, my neighbors are black, my coach is black, like my friends are black, my attorney's black, everybody's black around me. You're saying I'm the great white hope? And it tortured him. It tortured him to the point where when Ali lit the torch at, what was it, the LA Olympics, somebody asked Joe Frazier about it, and Joe Frazier said, I'd like to cut him into pieces and send him up to Jesus. If I was standing there, I would have pushed him into those Olympic flames. And I think that's the kind of power that Conor McGregor has over people. I think when he snatched that belt away, he got inside Jose Aldo's head, and he lived in there ever since. And I think that Jose Aldo did give it away. Christ almighty, Robin Black, you know, at the post-fight press conference said, Conor McGregor told me, he said, when I got face to face with Jose Aldo, he clenched up his right hand really, really hard. And I can guarantee you, Aldo was thinking about closing that fist up and smashing him in the face with it. And he wanted that so bad that it was obvious. And Conor slipped to the side and threw the left, and quickest title fight in UFC history.
Let me just jump in there for a second. Kirik, fantastic insight. Do you think it would have been a different fight had none of these mental war games happened? If you didn't have this crazy world tour, if you didn't have this beef, if Conor McGregor conducted himself like, say, Frankie Edgar would, do you think it would have been a completely different fight? Do you think that's what, you know, in some ways it came down to?
This gets back to something I alluded to earlier, which is that unlike MMA and boxing aren't games. They're not sports. You don't play them. They're fights. And as such, you can't separate the mental game from the physical game. The psychological aspect is just much, much bigger. The psychological aspect in a fight is, you know, 90% of it. So I can't separate. I can't say in my head, you know, technically, if you took out all the head games that Conor McGregor taunted and tortured Jose Aldo with, would he have won? I don't know. But those head games are so integral a part in this sport that I don't separate them.
Duane, I mean, it was a crazy moment. I had to pinch myself to see that I wasn't dreaming. I had to push a friend next to me to make sure that he wasn't dreaming. I mean, it was an unbelievable moment to see that happen in 13 seconds, no less. Tell us what you think. Do you think the mental game played a big part in this fight?
I think it did, you know, but it's a weird thing. I have to kind of eat a little bit here, because I thought that kind of looking at Jose at the weigh-ins and kind of how loose he looked, that he had kind of won the overall mental warfare. Because if you think about it, the move of the suspect rib injury, they come off this big buildup. Okay, he pulls out now McGregor has to fight Mendes and do this thing with Jose again. I was kind of like, oh, you know, I kind of could see Aldo kind of being a little maneuverish like that. But yeah, I didn't expect it to be 13 seconds. I mean, I could see there's a million ways that Conor could win, the same with Jose, but yeah, that was definitely an oh my God moment. But you know, this is interesting too. Like, I believe I saw it at, Jeremy Botter, had posted it on Twitter today, the video of the replay, when McGregor dusts Aldo, Frank Fertitta like stands up and slams the belt down. Like, mad. Like, I don't know what that reaction, and I'm curious to know what that reaction is about. Yeah, check it out. It's at Jeremy Botter's Twitter. It's a slow-mo or a vine, but when Aldo's clearly out and McGregor drops the hammer fist, Frank Fertitta just slams the title belt down cage side. So, I don't know.
Is this a different reaction to, you know, where you see Bruce Buffer and Dillashaw and all of Aldo's team? Is this a different angle?
Yeah, it's a different angle. Yeah, like I said, just pull it up on Twitter. You can see. I think he took it off TV.
Oh wow!
I mean, I think it's all visible on TV, but which is probably against copyrights, and he's probably gonna go to jail for that. But
yeah.
you're welcome, Jer. But that's why I think the Frankie Edgar fight is so compelling, because Conor said it himself at his post fight presser, that when you sign up to fight me, it's not a fight; it's all this other stuff. And that's true. You have to take on all this other mental stuff. And what better person than Frankie Edgar? That's the neighborhood kid from Tom's River who just loves to scrap. You're not going that you're not going to break Frankie Edgar mentally. It's just not going to happen. So, yeah, you know, Conor can talk his shit, and Frankie can, you know, and then I think stylistically, I think it's an awesome fight. And if Conor was to do what he did to Frankie, what he did to Aldo, to Frankie Edgar, then I say you just give the man the crown.
I mean,
I don't know.
I mean, you say that. You say he can't get in Frankie Edgar's head, but I feel like the sky's the limit as far as whose head Conor McGregor gets in. I mean, Jose Aldo was, it's not like he was some guy who had a couple of fights, you know, undefeated 10 years. Prior to this fight, best featherweight of all time, you know, came from the favelas and all that good stuff. As far as, you know, the way he looked, the whole world tour, it looked like he was very shook. All the way up until the weigh-in, I thought that Aldo... You know, that McGregor got in Aldo's head during the actual fight itself, or not so much during the fight because it only lasted a few seconds, but before the fight, I watched his entrance when he entered to Urijah Faber, or when he entered to fight Urijah Faber. It was literally exactly the same entrance, almost by timing, everything, his movements, the way he almost got lost and didn't know which way to run into the cage, it was exactly the same, and we saw how different those fights turned out. So I can't really say that I read anything from the way he entered. I agree with you guys. He looked very, very loose at the weigh-ins, and I thought, wow, maybe Conor McGregor shook. Maybe he, you know, maybe it was like a Ronda Rousey moment against Holly Holm in a sense where he didn't get the reaction that he was after. But just to sort of give you the first thoughts of what happened when the knockout blow landed, I was like you, Dennis. I couldn't believe what happened. The first thing I thought of was, wow, it's over. It's finally over. Like, after all this build-up, I mean, we were supposed to see this fight in July. We're in December. It's been half a year since we were originally supposed to see this fight. And, you know, then there was the massive build-up prior to that. And after all the, you know, that's been said and done, it's over in 13 seconds. Insane. Just absolutely amazing. Couldn't believe it.
I have to ask you guys, because the UFC recently released some locker room cam footage of Jose Aldo going back into his locker room. He was obviously distraught. It was a difficult moment for him. And Kirik, as a guy that's been involved in fighting for so long, you know, just like Muhammad Ali said, no one knows what to say in the loser's locker room. It's a difficult time for the team, for the fighter. I want to go to you first and ask you, do you think it's right for the UFC to release that footage? Do you think it makes it's fair to the fighters for fans to be able to see him at the most fragile at a moment like that? And I just want to get your thoughts on that, because it was pretty crazy when I saw that was released.
Yeah, when I saw that video, that's not something that we're going to put up on my site. I did think it was intrusive. It does get back to something I referred to a couple of times now, which is that mixed martial arts is a business and not 100% a sport. I don't think that it should have been put out there for every single person to see. I think it was a deeply personal moment. I think if Jose Aldo had been stark naked, they shouldn't have shown it. And I think he was stark naked emotionally, and they shouldn't have shown it. But it's a business, and it's the business that pays him. And that video probably made them some money. People found it poignant and compelling to see. So I can see both sides of it. But speaking personally, that's definitely not something that we're going to put up on my site.
Duane, I mean, Kirik just shared his opinions about not putting it up on the website. I mean, it's a situation where you got a guy who was who's your first ever champion. He's been there with you guys for a really long time. Do you think it was right for UFC to release that footage?
Oh, it was horseshit. It should have never happened. I mean, like, if you look at lesser sports, not lesser as in quality, but fighting so brutal and emotional and so primal in a sense. And then, like, think about the Super Bowl. You know, yeah, they do post-game press conferences, but anybody running into the losing quarterback through that interception and showing him sitting there crying? No, it doesn't happen in other sports. It shouldn't have happened in ours. I think just I saw a still on the internet of him sitting with his team in his locker room, and, you know, people are like, oh, there's a somber look. What the hell you think? Well, how else is this going to be? I think the guys back there doing jumping jacks being like, man, I'm sure glad I lost that belt in 13 seconds. No, it's raw. And that's the thing. Like, you know, I spend a tremendous amount of time with fighters. I mean, that's all I do. I don't do any opinion work. I just do fighter stories. And I see how these things happen, man. And I see how much goes into this, these processes. And then for this one night, this one thing in front of 17 people, everything can go wrong or everything can go right. I think that's what we love about it. But yeah, man, like, you know, with Conor celebrating, give Conor his stage, and there's no reason to release that video. Just kind of like the other, speaking about videos that disturbed me, were the Rousey video. I think it came off of the UFC pay-per-view because it, you know, it offers, UFC TV, I guess, offers multiple angles in camera or audio. But did you guys see the video where she's sitting up right after she, you know, they woke her up? And she's like, what? You know, I want to get back in there. And Herb Dean's telling Edmund, hey, you need to be honest with her. You know, like, that's brutal, man. Like, yes, we all love the sports. We love those moments. We love those knockouts. But there's a reality to it. And the reality is painful. And I think that we should let those fighters have their dignity.
Again,
because at that moment, they're vulnerable.
Playing advocate here, something that you mentioned about, you know, how raw and real that is. Do you think, and I'm not necessarily saying, yeah, we should release those moments, but do you think seeing those moments helps people understand just how real and raw it was? Because after the Ronda Rousey fight, obviously, you know, you've got a million memes about it, you've got a lot of people pouring salt in the wounds, and when you see those moments, do you think it helps people understand, like, wow, this is a human being, this isn't just, you know, some mythical character?
You know,
what do you think?
I think if we had a like a firm moral compass pointing north that was consistent, I'd say yeah. But we don't. People don't look for that type of sympathy. They look for it the other way. They're like, oh yeah, well look at the Ronda Rousey. Okay, first off, the person happiest that Ronda Rousey got knocked out was Anthony Berchek, because he was the meme the week before after Thomas Almeida knocked him out. And then we see the Rousey thing, and then it like blows up, and everybody's like, oh my gosh, feel sorry for Ronda. It's like, look, guys, you can't. And I saw, and the funny thing was I saw Carla Esparza, of all people, like tweeting, like, oh, this is unnecessary. You should not be mean. I'm like, lady, you bullied everybody that you encountered at that Tough House. You know what I mean? Like, so. It's such a back and forth culture of, you know, of what we think is okay and what's acceptable. But yeah, the let it be, man. Like, you know, the memes thing where it's just ridiculous. And then those, if I thought people were like, you know what, like you see Jose walking back and you could really understand, like, hey, where this kid came from and what he's done. Then you give him the emotional slow clap like a John Hughes movie, you know, like, yeah, that'd be great. But that's not the case. He's, you know, people are going to see him. So they're, oh, look, he's crying. Jose's crying, you know. You know, and so I think it's just best left alone.
And it's one of those situations as well where can you be safe? The locker room, the fighter locker room, is a place where you and your team go. And in a lot of ways, it's a safety place. It's a place where you go back after the fight. You go over your thoughts. You go over what happened. It's a very, very, I suppose, it's a very emotional place. It just felt to me, and you guys brought it up perfectly, that, you know, even though they may make money from it, everything that Jose Aldo has done in the company, if I was the UFC, I'd be like, you know what? This pay-per-view, it's probably done record numbers. All of our videos on YouTube are going to go over what we were hoping. I think we'll let this video slide, and we won't put it up, and we won't show people the side of Aldo where he's sitting there on the ground crying, you know, his family, his wife, his team's trying to console him. And it's also one of those situations, Cass, where you brought up the people see if it's that the whole thing's real. I actually think a lot of people use it as ammunition for more mean tweets, for more memes, for more vines. You're giving people an opportunity to have that video footage, and they can do whatever they want with it. And I mean, we've all been in situations, all of us here on the conversation, where we've written an article, or we've done a video, or we've put up something on a website, and you've gotten some horrible comments. And even though it's all a part of the business, we get used to it. And it sometimes lets us look back on our work. But if we went back into our bedroom at the end of the night and we had a really shitty day and we were there with our family and we were upset about it, I don't think anybody would want that video released, because you're so vulnerable at that time. And I just really didn't like it. I really thought the UFC didn't need to reveal it. What the video showed was, I suppose, it didn't really add anything to the situation. And you get all these fans jumping on there, putting in all this salt into the wound of a guy who was once a pound for pound best, you know, being knocked down in 13 seconds and not even being able to go into his locker room and sit there on the ground and cry. So
I thought that was very not very classy at all, and I really hope that the UFC don't do it in the future. But let's just jump back to McGregor before we wrap up, guys, because this has been going for a while, and we appreciate your time. He mentioned he has plans on becoming a dual champion. I want to go to you first, Kirik. What do you think? Is it possible to have a dual champion in the UFC if Conor McGregor does go up to lightweight and somehow win a title? Do you think it's possible for a fighter to have both titles at once? Or do you think it's going to bring up issues in the UFC if that does happen?
I wrote before the fight that I thought this was going to be Conor McGregor's last fight at 145. He looks like death warmed over at the weigh-ins, and he appears also to be his musculature appears to be getting larger and larger. I don't think we're ever going to see him fight at 145 again. I think he's gonna have fights with the UFC over it. He's gonna want to at some point walk in with two belts over his shoulder. They may allow him to do that, but I think he's gonna have to vacate the 145 and move up to 155. That said, I've got a friend who's a music manager, and the guy asked me out of curiosity how the business worked in mixed martial arts, and we talked about it for 15 minutes or something. And he said, okay, he said, at some point a fighter's going to come along who's bigger than the organization, and at that point the power is going to switch. And he said that's going to be, and he took me through the music business and how it happened, and the movie business and how it happened. He said it's going to happen in your business. And I thought it might be John Jones, but there's something about John Jones's personality that doesn't quite, human beings just don't like him, many of them. Ronda Rousey, I think she's a woman, and people just can't quite project into a woman what they can into a man. But I think that breakthrough figure is upon us. I think it's Conor McGregor. And so he may be able to sort of force them to give him two titles. But I don't think we're going to see Conor McGregor fighting at 145 ever again.
Duane, Conor McGregor was adamant that he's not going to be giving up his 145 title belt and going over to the UFC lightweight and winning that second belt. I mean, do you agree with Kirik? Is it possible for him to have both belts? Are his days of 145 numbered? I mean, John Kavanaugh said no more. What do you think about this whole situation?
I think we'll see him at 45 again. I think we'll at least see him defend it. He worked so hard to get there. I think we'll see him defend it. I've been saying this whole time, I got a pretty good feeling that the Edgar fight makes sense, because, you know, other than fighting Cerrone, you know, because there's sellable beef there between those two, and that would be a hot button issue. But kind of adding on to what Kirik said, like, what if we're in this time now where Conor McGregor kind of Frankensteins the UFC? You know, he says, hey, you know, like, well, you created me, I'm bigger. You know, like, what is Mayweather co-promotes his own stuff, right? Like, that's mm-hmm. that was his breakaway deal.
Yeah,
like he's his own promotion company, and I just think that I can see some things with the UFC. Maybe that's what that belt slam was about from Uncle Frank. You know, who knows?
Mm.
But Conor has clout. You know, that's the thing. Conor has clout, and he's changing the game in a certain way. You know, kind of the way that Steph Curry's kind of changing the way things are flowing in the NBA, the way Jordan changed the way, you know, from the Magic and Dr. J era. You know, I know those are lofty comparisons, but Kirik said Muhammad Ali earlier, so I can get away with that.
Yeah.
But I think he's something special. The dude is something special, and he's must-see TV. So I think he's worked really hard on the promotional side of it. And mark my words, this is where Conor McGregor pushes back.
Yeah.
So I don't think it's going to be pretty. I think he's going to start making demands, and, you know, he's going to start saying, hey, look, you know, I'm the show here, and it could be, it's going to be interesting no matter what.
Yeah, clout's good. You can never have too much clout. And something that we mentioned, the Errol Hawani interview just before, but something that sort of wasn't mentioned is when, and in the interview itself, it was kind of washed over, was when Errol asked him if everything's okay between him and the UFC, and kind of said, no. And then they just kind of washed over it. And I was like, what does that mean? What do you mean? Why no? What is the issue there? And I agree with you guys. This may see, you phrased it perfectly. You said Conor McGregor might Frankenstein the UFC. I'd be very curious to see if that happens. But just from a logistics point of view, to see him defending the 45 belt and the 55 belt, I think it'd be a nightmare. You've got this massive event, UFC 194, with obviously Conor McGregor and the title being on the line. And then next week, we've got Cerrone and RDA. If Conor is, you know, the champion of both divisions, and that's a big if, that's a big hypothetical, you can't do that. You can't have these two big events like that. And the way the UFC is with injuries, and you never know what's going to happen. I mean, just timing-wise, what if you've got two contenders? What if you've got, say, Frankie Edgar, Max Holloway? They're fighting. Boom, you've got the number one contender. We're ready for the title. Oh, sorry, Conor McGregor's going to be fighting in 3 months for the lightweight belt. Or what, he's going to be defending the lightweight belt. What do you do with Edgar and Holloway? Well, sorry, guys. Now, even though you've got a number one contender, you guys have to take another fight. And the same thing can happen at lightweight as well. So just from a logistics standpoint, it'd be a nightmare for the UFC. And it really, like, if Conor McGregor says he's going to be fighting, what, five times a year or four times a year, he's going to be fighting almost every 2 months. You can't keep a schedule like that over long term. I think eventually his body's going to break down. And not only that, even if he does fight often, there's always the risk of injuries and these massive fights falling out. And you can't just say, well, that's all right, the featherweight title fell out this weekend, we've got the lightweight belt defended next weekend, or we're just going to switch around. This guy holds both belts. Again, this is all a big hypothetical. I don't think the UFC are going to let him, at least willingly, hold both belts.
It's interesting. You guys mentioned there might be a rift between the UFC and Conor McGregor. Imagine we see a second coming of the Tito Ortiz-Dana White saga. If it does happen, though, Dana White wouldn't be able to fight Conor McGregor, so maybe Dave Scholler can do the rights because he's a little bit smaller. But, guys, we'd like to thank Kirik Jenness from the UG. Make sure to check out mixedmartialarts.com and also MMA.tv. You guys need to go on this website. A lot of great clips on the website. Kirik does an amazing job. Make sure you go on there. And also, obviously, mixedmartialarts.com has all your latest MMA news. Make sure to follow Kirik on Twitter, at Kirik Jenness. And thank you to Duane Finley, who's actually working on a piece with Carlos Condit. Duane, just quickly for the fans, this is remarkable. I mean, long pieces where people follow around fighters, it's almost extinct in our industry at the moment. There's a lot of smaller articles out there. Tell us about the project that you're doing with Carlos Condit at the moment.
Well, before I get into that, I want to say, kind of echo what you said about Kirik's site, man. Like, that's it. Like, the underground's, that's the jam. You know, the underground was cool from day one. It's still cool all these years later. We all go on there and check it out. And so, you know, hats off to Kirik for that. You know what's different about this Condit thing is I'm doing it gonzo. Like, I'm doing it, you know, gonzo style, you know, because I'm not a journalist. I've never been a journalist. I'm a storyteller. You know, that's what I do. I come from a creative background. I didn't get a degree. You know, I worked at a lumber yard. So, I've just made my name in this sport telling fighters stories. And I do these. I'm passionate. You know, I believe the first time we ever spoke, I was on a road trip across the country, you know, chasing this idea, which is now coming out in a book. The book comes out in April, and that's a pretty dark little thing to pick up. So it is less of an MMA book than it is just kind of an experience book. So,
wow.
Yeah, I have to see it. If I can see it, then I can explain it to you in a way that I can make you understand it. And you look at a guy like Carlos Condit, and you're like, there's something. You get a visceral reaction when he fights. He's such a cool, chill guy outside of the cage, but then that switch flips and he's a monster. It's that killer instinct. So I'm like, I want to know where that come from. And I'm like, that has to come from somewhere. And sure enough, I spent a month in Albuquerque. I have a wonderful wife and two kids who miss me but understand what dad's doing. I spent a month out in Albuquerque, and they come out every Monday on MMA Junkie. So tomorrow they'll come out. But then also during my time out there, I also kind of chance intersected with Cerrone. So then I spent a couple nights at the ranch and kind of followed and did some stuff with him as well. So I have a surviving Cerrone series that starts in the build up to fight week. But yeah, wow. And that dude is as wild as advertised. The guy gives zero shits. But the, like you said, this, these longer things that are kind of extinct. And that's what made me so happy about the Carlos thing, is that people have received it really well. And it's not the, it's not the praise that I enjoy. It's the fact that the Rousey versus Mayweather headline bullshit that dominated for 6 months, you know, then you have like Chuck Mendenhall fighting, wrote this great story on Jason Thacker, and yeah, Sean El Shadi's written some stuff. Thomas Trabasi's written some stuff. And then there are people like, yeah, yeah, those are cool. And then they're like, psh, but then 500,000 people are like, hey, let's check out Mayweather Rousey for the 15th time. So
don't forget the Doug Crosby piece.
Yeah, yeah, you know. Oh yeah, absolutely right. That Crosby piece was awesome. And the long form stuff, you know, that people want to read it and they'll get invested in it, and then you write it in a serial way where they can follow along. I just couldn't be happier. You know, I'm excited about it, and I hope everybody checks it out.
Well, there you guys go. Make sure you jump onto it. There's a few installments out already, which means there is some good reading for you guys wherever you like to do it. And also make sure to follow Dwayne, who's a survivor of hanging with Donald Cerrone, on Twitter at Duane Finley MMA. Guys, it's been a pleasure, and thank you so much for coming onto the program. We'll be right back after this short break.
Hi, guys. It's Joanna Jędrzejczyk, UFC strawweight champion. Listen to Submission Radio.
There you have it, guys. An extensive breakdown from the one and only Kirik Jenness and Duane Finley. I love having those guys on. It's crazy that we haven't had Duane on in, I think it's been a year, possibly more. He was one of our very, very early guests, and having him on makes me wish we've had him on more often. So a guy that we'll have to get back on, Kirik Jenness, obviously an absolute legend in the sport, pioneer, The Underground, which is a legendary site in on itself, so you have to go there and check it out. So we appreciate having those guys on, but that's almost it. We're coming towards the end of the episode. Another monumental UFC event, another fun episode of Submission Radio that hopefully you guys enjoyed.
Yeah, that's right. And big thank you, like you mentioned, to all the guests. And guys, if you still haven't, jump on our YouTube channel. It's youtube.com/submissionradioau. If you haven't been on there for the past week, we actually do have a whole bunch of UFC 194 content for you. Me and Kacper couldn't make it down there personally, but we had Team Submission Radio up there shooting some videos for you guys. Just some of the stuff that stands out to me, Kacper, that I think people should check out. There were a lot of great interviews in the prelims, where you saw a lot of the prelim guys like Yancy Medeiros, Court McGee. You had guys like Leonardo Santos, Tisha Torres, for example, talking about their wins. If you haven't had a chance to check those out, please do. It's interesting to see their perspective. Also, before those prelim interviews happened, before UFC 194 happened, there were a bunch of big names doing interview scrums. We have Donald Cowboy Cerrone for you. He talks about loving the idea of Conor McGregor coming to lightweight. TJ Dillashaw, man, this guy dropped some bombs, some big bombs on Chael Sonnen. Also talks about fighting Urijah. I mean, that's a great one to check out. Holly Holm discusses the Ronda Rousey rematch. I mean, what else could you ask for? There's also some stare downs with guys like Dillashaw, Cruz, Verdum, Velasquez, a whole bunch of them. I really recommend you guys have a look at that. Very, very interesting. Kind of shows you some of the big fights coming up very, very soon. And also, if you guys didn't get a chance, Holly Holm, she did a bit of a Q&A in front of Irish fans, which, yeah, Holly Holm, she's a good egg. She kept her head on nice and straight, even though she got some weird questions asked of her. But there was one point where the crowd began to sing to her. It started with one fan, then the whole crowd began. We have that clip up on the channel. Check it out. Holly Holm also talks about that infamous Beyonce moment, Cass, where she asked her what her name was. She describes it to the people, because you're like, who doesn't know who Beyonce is? Well, she did. She was just taken by the moment, and she explains what happened. So check that out. And also all the stuff leading into the fights, if you want to sort of look back on it all and really kind of see where these guys were before the fights happened. We've got open workouts with Conor McGregor, Jose Aldo, Chris Weidman, Luke Rockhold, and a bunch of scrum interviews with Urijah Faber, Gunnar Nelson, Yoel Romero, who actually gets emotional and cries during it. So check it all out. There's a lot of great stuff on the channel.
And also, just as far as post-fight stuff, obviously Conor McGregor had his own press conference. We've got that up there. And we've also split a few key parts from that Conor McGregor press conference. I believe it was Kirik Jenness who mentioned the Robin Black moment, where Robin Black reads him what Conor McGregor said to him a few days prior, and the way he predicted exactly how the fight was going to go. We've got that there separately, that moment where Robin Black tells him about it, and Conor McGregor talks about how he predicted the fight. There's also a few other moments that we've split separately about where Conor McGregor declares himself the number one pound-for-pound fighter, Also, Conor McGregor on wanting to do Mayweather-Pacquiao-type numbers, and also where he talks about what's next and that he definitively says he's not vacating his belt when he moves up. So the YouTube channel is stacked to the tits. There's plenty of stuff. Of course, if you are watching this on YouTube, just to let you know, this show is always available on other podcast platforms. So if you are on the go, yeah, you want to, you know, go for a jog, or you're out, or you're at work and your boss is looking over at you, and you're pretending that you're working, but really listen to Submission Radio. We are obviously available on iTunes, Stitcher, SoundCloud, TuneIn Radio, and pretty much any other podcast platform. You can always chat with us on Twitter at SubmissionAUS, Facebook.com/SubmissionRadioAU. We love chatting with you guys. Also, in the comment section below, again, if you are watching on YouTube, drop some comments. Let us know what you thought of the show. Hit the like button. And of course, give us your thoughts on UFC 194 in general. We were talking to you guys quite a bit before UFC 194. I think just before the event, we sort of, not to say we didn't look at the comments, we didn't have quite as much time to sort of respond. Now the event's over, we've got plenty of time to chat to you guys all day long. We absolutely love doing it. Just to give you guys a little bit of an update, this is obviously an isolated sort of show after these big events like we did after UFC 189. We do these breakdown specials. Next week, the show goes back to its regular format, you know, three or so guests, and then a breakdown of whatever event's happening, which will be UFC on Fox 17.
That's right, guys. So that will be our last episode for the year. We'll take a couple of week break, but we'll talk to you guys more about that next week and let you know exactly when we're coming back. And without further ado, thank you for tuning in. We'll catch you next week.